Mary Culhane of the Dead Man, written by Jeff McDonald. Mary Culhane lived in a faraway Ireland, which is nicknamed Too Faraway Ireland, since it is so remote. She was the oldest of six children, and they were poor. Dirt poor, as you might say. For her father earned a meager living by digging graves at the graveyard near the far edge of their small rural town. One day her father came home, bone-tired as he always was, and he plopped himself down in his comfortable easy chair. As the tension of the day left him, he let out a sigh of relief.
Girl.
Mary then heard him exclaim from his resting place. Hi, I can't believe it. I left me prized blackthorn organ stick back at the tree. The only thing me dear father gave me. It'd probably be gone by the morning. He exclaimed in disgust at his own mistake. Mary Culhane ran from the kitchen, grabbed her shawl, and bolted to the door.
I'll get it for you, father.
She ran out the door before anyone could stop her, for no one, absolutely no one, went into the cemetery after dark. And indeed, it was dark before she got there. A big moon, though, was just on the horizon as she entered the cemetery gate. She had been here many times before the graveyards and didn't scare her, but that was in the daytime. She carefully walked around the graves, for she'd been taught from the time she was a wee lass not to walk over them. It was bad luck. She picked her way around the graves until she saw the walking stick lying against the old oak tree. Why, her father must have stopped her there to have his lunch and forgot it. In a rush to retrieve the stick, Mary forgot to watch where she was, stepping and fell into an open grave. As quickly as she could, she got up on her hands and knees, but as she did, she felt someone, or something, crawl on her back. Before she could even try to get whatever it was off of her, an evil voice whispered in her ear.
Ah, Mary Culhane, I've been waiting for you. Now you must take me in town to get something to eat. For I hunger and thirst.
Mary knew this was an evil creature. She could tell by its scaly fingers and fetid breath. Mary realized that she suddenly had no will of her own. She was helpless and fated to do only as the evil creature bade her. She reached up to the top of the grave and pulled with all her strength. She felt as if she were bearing the weight of the world on her shoulders, but somehow she managed to lift herself and the creature onto the soft grass above. She lay prone while creature screamed,
"Get up, Mary Culhane! Get up and take me into town!"
Mary slowly rose. With that creature riding her back, she trudged toward the village. They came to the main road where the first house appeared.
Now, Mary Culhane, take me into this house or I may feed.
Mary tried to resist but was unable. So when she reached for the first step, the second step, and was ready to reach for the third, the creature cried out,
"Not here, Mary Culhane, for I smell the stench of holy water."
Mary stepped down and went to the second house.
"Now, Mary Culhane, bring me inside this house."
But again, she reached the third step, and the creature cried in pure agony,
"No, Mary Culhane, take me away! For I smell the stench of holy water."
Mary again retreated and walked down the road until they came to the third house. She took the first step, the second, the third, and the creature said not a word.
"Take me into the kitchen, Mary, and find me something to eat."
Mary walked down the darkened hallway to the kitchen. There she let the creature slide off her back onto a chair.
"Quickly, Mary Culhane, I don't have much time."
Mary looked all about. Finally, she said,
I'm sorry, all I can find is some oatmeal and some dirty water.
Ah, Mary Culhane, I will teach these people to not leave me anything. Let me on your back.
Mary again did as the creature commanded to do.
Now, take me up these stairs.
No, no!
Mary screamed inside her head, for she knew this family, and she knew that the three boys, her classmates, slept upstairs. But she was powerless under the weight of the evil one's spell. She slowly made her way to the top of the stairs. There in the moonlight, she could barely make out figures of the three boys fast asleep on their beds. The creature slid off her back and went over to each boy. He took out a sharp knife and slit each boy's finger. With the first drop of blood, their breathing stopped. With the second drop of blood, their hearts stopped beating. With the third drop of blood, all life left their bodies. He took the vial of blood and climbed on Mary's back.
Take me back down to the kitchen, Mary Culhane, so we may feast.
Mary, sad, had no choice but to walk down the stairs and into the kitchen. The creature slid off Mary's back and onto the chair. He took the oatmeal and poured it into two bowls. Then he took a vial of blood and began to pour it over the oatmeal. When he finished, he gave one bowl to Mary and said,
"Now eat this."
"No, no,"
she cried. She could not eat this bloody gruel, not stained with the blood of her friends.
"Do it, and do it now."
She picked up a spoon and brought a spoonful to her lips. The creature, satisfied, picked up his bowl and began greedily to gobble his portion down. Mary saw her chance. She quickly, spoonful by bloody spoonful, put the tainted oatmeal into the folds of her neckerchief around her neck. She had just finished when the creature put down his bowl and wiped his bloody mouth with his tattered sleeve.
"Ah, Mary Culhane, I see you are done. Now clean this place so no one will know we have been here."
Mary reached for the two bowls and began to wash them out. She waited until the creature turned away and put the neckerchief into the two bowls into the cabinet.
"Hurry, Mary Culhane. I must get back to my grave before morning."
She slowly walked over and again positioned himself on her back. She turned to go back down to the hallway.
"No, Mary Culhane. We cannot leave by the way we came.
For 'tis the way with all evil creatures. They must return by a different path." So Mary turned around and went out the back door. She was ready to walk down the steps when the creature laughed in his insane laughter.
"Ah, Mary Culhane, tell me what you see."
Mary looked out on the horizon.
"I see three hills. They call the Haunted Hills."
Now Mary Culhane began to fear for her own life.
"Do you know why, Mary Culhane?" "I'll tell you why. Because buried in that little mound is all the gold and silver the evil ones have gathered over the many years. But only the dead know of it."
So now she knew of the gold. He wouldn't possibly let her live knowing the secret. On and on into the night they went, the creature laughing, talking, and telling stories. Evil stories that no one wants to hear. The moon set in the western sky, throwing the sky into pitch black. Finally, started to approach the cemetery, back by the road. As they did, a rooster crowed.
"Ah! Mary Culhane! What is that awful noise?"
Mary knew full well it was a rooster, and that this must be close at hand. But, he said,
this is nothing but the bleeding of a sheep.
Hurry, Mary Culhane, hurry!
Mary reached the graveyard and was trying to find her way around the graves when the inky black sky turned a soft gray, and again they heard the rooster crowing.
Ah, Mary Culhane, what is that foul noise?
It is nothing, I say, but the bark of a dog.
Quickly, Mary Culhane, for I feel myself weakened.
Mary saw the oak tree. She saw the open grave. She walked slowly towards it. Just then, the sky broke open, and the first beam of morning drew across the sky and into the graveyard. The rooster crowed for a third time. Mary felt the creature jump, frightened, from her shoulders and slither into the pit. As it did, it cried,
Ah, Mary Culhane, you tricked me. I don't have time to kill you. If I would know that you were to live, I never would have told you of the gold.
Suddenly, a great weight had been lifted from her shoulders, and at once she had her will to do as she would. She glanced down in the grave, but all she saw were the whitened bones of the evil creature. She grabbed her father's walking stick, used it to tilt the creature's head over, causing it to crash down upon him within his grave. Then Mary used it as she hurried home. Once there, she threw herself onto a bed and fell into a deep sleep. A couple of hours passed when her mother ran into her room.
Mary, wake up. Something terrible has happened in town. Mary, please wake up.
Mary stirred, and her mother could see that her hair was matted and tangled, and darkened circles smudged her eyes. Her dress was dirty and looked like blood stained her apron. Her mother backed out of the room, scared.
Mary, just get some sleep. Or meet us at your friend's home, the one with the three boys.
Mary again fell into a deep sleep, but this time was full of dreams. Dreams of an evil creature, the boys, the knife, the blood. Oh, the blood! Then she suddenly awoke. She realized it wasn't a dream. It had happened. But she remembered something else. As they were walking back to the graveyard, she had asked the evil creature if there wasn't some way, that those boys could have lived. The creature just laughed.
Mary Culhane, there was a way. There's always a way. You see, if they were to drink their own blood, they could have lived. But as you ate your potion, now there's no way.
But there was a way. She hadn't eaten her portion. Maybe, just maybe. She got herself bathed, put on a fresh dress, and headed toward town. When she got to the boys' home, she could see that the entire village was trying to console the desolate parents. When she went up to the father and said,
Please let me inside.
Oh, Mary, I can't do that. What is upstairs in that bedroom is not fit for a young lass to see.
You don't understand. I know a way to save their lives. I beg you.
Ah, Mary, if you could save me three sons' lives, I'd give you anything in my power to give.
Just let me go in alone, she demanded.
The father cleared the house, and Mary entered. She walked down the darkened hallway to the kitchen. She opened the cabinet, and there was a neckerchief right where she had left it. She grabbed a spoon and went up to the stairs. She saw the lifeless forms of the three boys. She gently went over and put the spoon to their lips. With the first drop of blood, gasp, the boy began to breathe. And the second drop of blood, their hearts started to beat. And with the third drop of blood, all life came back into their bodies. What a rejoicing there was. When Mary walked outside, and behind her the three boys were alive and well. For 3 days and 3 nights, there was a celebration like none before. On the third night, the father came to Mary.
Mary, you have made me the happiest man to ever live. You gave me my three boys back. And Mary, I want to give you something. Anything, name it. Please, Mary, tell me.
Well, Mary said.
Would you deed me that land behind your house? The one with the three hills on it?
I'd give you that and much more.
As the oldest of the three boys, who was Mary's age, walked up and took her hand. So right there they wrote up a contract. After a long courtship, and when Mary had become of age, she married that boy. And don't you know what they built the foundation of their house between the two hells? And when they dug down, they found gold. Gold and jewels and silver. There was enough that Mary Culhane was a rich woman, and her father would never have to pick up a shovel again. She had another stone slab placed over the creature's grave, and a headstone placed with a particular warning. In this graveyard, never go, unless soon the rooster will crow. And even though the events of that night slowly faded away like a bad dream, there was something Mary Culhane never forgot, and that was to keep holy water at the front.